All right, I think we're going to get started here today. I just wanted to make sure that everyone can hear me. So if you can hear me, just type in yes. All right, I think we are good to go. So welcome to this presentation on SOLIDWORKS Simulation Standard. My name is Sashi Sitambaram. I am a simulation specialist here with CAD Dimensions. I am presenting today from our Syracuse location, but I generally you can find me in the our new location, CAD Dimensions new location out in Westchester, in White Plains. So for today, I will talk about SOLIDWORKS Simulation Standard. And if you have any questions during the presentation, you can type it in the there's a questions panel in your GoTo meeting. So type in the question, and at the end of the presentation today, we can go through those, and I'll try to answer your questions. Okay, so let's go ahead. So, SOLIDWORKS simulation packages. So for today, as I mentioned, we are going to be talking about the SOLIDWORKS simulation standard, which includes the linear static for assembly. So any static analysis which includes parts and assembly can be analyzed with the SOLIDWORKS simulation standard. With the standard package, you also have the time-based motion, so any analysis which includes dynamics or kinematics, any kind of mechanism can also be analyzed. To take it a step further, once you've run your linear static analysis, you can also run a failure analysis with our fatigue analysis. And we also have a trend tracker, which will allow you to create iterations of your model and assembly and evaluate which part of assembly would be better. So just to kind of briefly talk about the other packages that we have, the SOLIDWORKS Simulation Professional, it's the next step over where we have the capabilities of running frequency, thermal analysis, event-based motion, which is a step above the time-based motion, where you can set up multiple events of your mechanisms and run it simultaneously. We also have an optimization analysis in our Simulation Professional, which will allow you to set up some constraints and criterias. And the software will basically evaluate the best combination of those constraints that you've set. To take it a step further, we also have the SOLIDWORKS Simulation Premium. So if you are running any kind of analysis which requires you to know what happens past the yield strength, so that's when you get into the nonlinear analysis. We have the dynamic and static analysis for nonlinear. And if you have any applications which requires harmonic or vibration or random vibration, we also have a linear dynamic package within the Simulation Premium. All right, so SOLIDWORKS Simulation Standard. So for today's agenda, I'm going to present to you the standard package by answering these questions. Will my product last? How long will my product last? What if I have any kind of mechanisms, as I said, any kind of kinematics or dynamics in my application? How do I evaluate those? And when it comes to designing, you may have multiple iterations, and how do you evaluate which is the best design? So will my product last? So when it comes to your basic static analysis, essentially you would go through five steps. The first step is you need to apply all your materials, you create your fixtures, you apply the loads within your application, you solve it, and you process the results and evaluate whether anything needs to be changed for the first three steps. So let's go ahead and take a look at an example in the software. So here I have a crank bike paddle assembly. And what I want to evaluate here is so when designing a paddle like this, you're paddling, there might be some instances where the person on the bike might coast, and at that moment they might shift the entire weight onto one side of the paddle. So the goal here is that we want to know at that instantaneous second where all that force is being applied onto the load, what happens to that paddle? Will it be able to withstand those forces? So within the Office product of the SOLIDWORKS user interface, you can actually see the SOLIDWORKS simulation add-in has been turned on. You can see that it's pushed in, it's indented. And once you've turned this on, you have your simulation toolbar. Now, what's nice about SOLIDWORKS simulation standard is that everything is ingrained within the SOLIDWORKS software itself. So this would work with any version of SOLIDWORKS that you may have already. So if you have SOLIDWORKS standard or professional or premium, you'd be able to tie in the SOLIDWORKS simulation standard with that. So within the simulation toolbar, you can easily just start a new study. And so for this, I'm just going to say prototype, so PT1. So I'll say prototype test 1, and I hit the green check mark. So this now creates the initial study layout for me. Now what's nice about the simulation standard within SOLIDWORKS is that to set up your analysis, essentially all you have to do is go down the list, which is very similar to designing in SOLIDWORKS. As long as you go from top to bottom, you are all set to run your analysis. So just kind of going through that five steps again to set up your analysis, you have to start with your setting up your materials. So when I drop the parts, you can see here that I already have some materials set up. Now, if we take a look at the model itself, this is an assembly with parts in it, and within this assembly itself, all the parts already have materials assigned to it. So as soon as you start your simulation analysis, all that information actually gets transferred over into your simulation study. So you don't have to reassign material. All that data that you've reassigned before gets transferred over. So this is especially helpful when you have custom materials. So in this case, you can see for my crank design here, I have a chromium steel, and it is a custom material. And that custom material was created within my part. It was transferred right into my simulation analysis. Now, the software actually helps you to create your custom material as it color codes it whenever you have a simulation analysis tied into it. Whenever it has a red property, it means that it requires those values to be to exist. If it's blue, it's recommended that it is that is included. So the basic requirement to be able to run a static analysis is all the red has to be filled in. Let's hit quote. All right. So having the simulation package again tied in right into SOLIDWORKS, you'll be able to use all the SOLIDWORKS functionalities right within the simulation standard package. So the next step for this analysis is to set up some constraints. So in this case, I'm going to set up some fixtures. So to set up a fixture, right click, and you can pick from this list of different fixtures that you may have. So let's just say I pick on fixed geometry. You can actually see that there's an example here with a simple cantilever beam, and it shows that the face that you pick and the reaction that you may get from that type of fixture. So for this analysis, we do have a bike paddle which essentially rotates. So what we're going to do is we're actually going to set a fixed hinge here, and again, having the access to SOLIDWORKS user interface, I can use shortcut keys such as the X key here, which will allow me to only select on faces. I could also hit my G key on my keyboard, and that allows me to magnify certain areas that I would like to apply my fixture. That. So all that fixed hinge right there. So just to kind of overview some other fixtures that we have, we also have some advanced fixtures here where you can actually create some symmetry conditions, you can create some circular conditions, and even use some reference geometry which will allow you to set up some translation. So you can even say that my part is going to move by X distance, and you can apply that within your application as well. So I'm going to set up one more fixed hinge here for the back. This model right here. Okay. All right. So now that we have our fixtures set, again, just kind of going down this list, we need to create an external load. So again, just like everything else in SOLIDWORKS, right-click will give you all the options for that folder. So for this case, I can right-click this and say force. SOLIDWORKS also has some hotkeys where you can hit the S key and you can access tools quickly right in here. So you can see that I have my force set up right in here. Click on that and I can simply select on faces where that force may be applied onto. So when it comes to forces, the default is always to set it in the normal direction. However, you have the ability to say select a direction and even pick planes and have that that force move in different directions. So obviously for this example, we're going to have it going vertically down, so it is going to be normal onto that face. And I'm going to set this, you can see that right now it's in newtons, but the values that I have for this force is in English units, so I can change it right here. You can see that SOLIDWORKS actually does the conversion for me. So for this, I'm going to say 300 pound force on that face. And I'm actually going to say total. And what this actually does is it will evenly distribute that 300 pound force onto that surface based on the surface area that you may have. So you don't have to do those types of calculations. All you need to do is have the total force and apply all the different faces where that force is being applied onto. Hit the green check mark. So again, just kind of going through that five steps again. We have the material setup, we have the fixtures and the load setup. All we need to do now is set up our mesh. So to create a mesh, you can actually just right click the mesh and say create mesh. And for the mesh application, it's fairly simple. There is a dial here that you could move up and down, whether you want it to be coarse or fine. If you want more control of your mesh, just simply check the mesh parameter, and you have your standard mesh, and you have a step above that where you can create a curvature-based mesh where you can actually put in some numbers. So as I put in number here, you can see this dial actually moves. And that's essentially what happens when you're when you move this dial up and down. Okay. And just to show you that there is also you can see that it created the measure, and at this point I could actually just hide some of this fixtures and loads just to give me a clearer picture of the mesh itself. And under the mesh settings itself, we do have the ability to create something called a mesh control. And what this mesh control allows you to do is take it even one step above the mesh that you already have and create localized mesh and create denser mesh in certain areas. So if there are certain areas where there are higher stress concentrators, you could create, you could select faces or edges. So if you just hover over this select entity box here, you can see that you can pick faces, edges, vertices, reference points, and even components to create a much finer mesh at a controlled localized areas. So we're not going to really do that for this. I just wanted to show you. So now once we have everything set up, all we really need to do now is just hit run. See that how that solves. And you can see how fast SOLIDWORKS simulation was able to solve that analysis. And SOLIDWORKS simulation actually has one of the best and fastest solvers in the industry. So let's quickly take a look at some of the results that we have here. You can see that right off the bat, I got the stresses, the von Mises stresses on my model. I can easily double click on my legend right here. I can say show max annotation. And I can say okay, and it will tell me exactly where the maximum stresses are on this crank here. We can also add more results. So let's just say I want to take a look at some of my principal stresses. I can say define a stress plot. I can say I have my P1, P2, and P3 stress plots. So let's just say the first principal stress, let's keep it at PSI. Okay, here now I can actually take a look at some of the tensile stress that I have on my crank design. So just to go back into our PowerPoint here, you can see that essentially what we've done here is we've set up the material, so we were able to reuse the material from the CAD model. Also define custom materials within our part and bring it into our assembly. So reusing existing data, we were able to apply fixtures consider the surrounding connections that we may have in our assembly. We were able to apply the loads in our brake pedal. So depending on how the weight of the rider, as I said, when the rider is coasting and kind of leaning to one side, there are different loads and stresses, that are forces that we can apply to our model, and you can pick different directions for that to give you a better simulated environment. And you can solve, and as you can see how quick and accurate results were. I ran that in real time, and you were able to see how fast it was able to mesh and give you a reliable information. So once we have our results, we will easily able to check our existing results and also add more results such as the principal stressors that we went through earlier. Alright, so up next, we can take a look at how long my product will last. So if we take a step back into our model, so this model that we have here is the instantaneous second where that load was applied. Now we can easily check for a factor of safety for this model. So I'm just going to say define factor of safety plot. I'm going to say for all bodies, and you can pick the different type of solvers. So for a stress plot, SOLIDWORKS simulation uses von Mises, but for your factor of safety, you have all the different stress calculations such as Tresca or Moore column. So for this, I'm just going to say max von Mises stress, and I'm going to set the upper limit just to 10 here. Say next. So the yield strength criteria comes right from the material that was set through the simulation analysis. Say next. And I'm just going to say, show me the factor of safety set, factor of safety distribution for this analysis. Say okay. And you can clearly see how the factor of safety looks in this case. And the minimum factor of safety that was calculated is 1.2. So just to give you a better representation, what I could do is I could flip the colors here. Okay, that gives you a better idea of where the model may fail or may pass. So it seems like, you know, with the minimum factor of safety of 1.2, we have a pretty decent model. However, will this model last over a certain amount of usage, a certain amount of cycles? So that's where fatigue analysis comes into play. So when it comes to fatigue analysis, you can see that we have the background for it is metal fatigue is the most common failure for mechanisms, and 50 to 90% range of failures are due to fatigue, and this is something that can be seen in practically, you know, every industry, every engineering industry where parts could fail. So this picture right here is the actual bike paddle that we were just looking at. So take just a mental image of that, and we'll run a fatigue analysis in SOLIDWORKS and kind of compare it with this actual fatigue that we see in this picture here. Fatigue analysis is also important in a lot of cases. Parts are over designed to reduce failure. However, when you have a stress concentrated in a certain area and there's a crack, over time that stress could build up, and eventually it could just break right through the part. So there's no real way to analyze actual fatigue for your part. So running a fatigue analysis is extremely important when it comes to producing good parts and assemblies. So let's kind of take a look at, go back into the model that we have. So to set up a fatigue analysis, say new study, and you can see that we have fatigue right here. So I'm just going to say fatigue, FTG, click on that, say okay, Now, to set up a fatigue analysis, it's fairly simple. All you have to do is right-click on your loading and say Add Event. Now, you'll see right here, the first option right here is to specify how many cycles. So, in this brake paddle, it was predicted that over the lifetime of this paddle, a rider might coast perhaps 3.5 million times. So just to keep it safe, you know, they would probably double that value. So we could say 7 million times. And the type of loading that you can have, you can either have it at fully reversed, you can have it at zero base. So when it's fully reversed, it goes from 0 to 1 to -1. If it's zero base, it goes from 0 to 1. You can even specify the loading ratio or even find cycle peaks for your based on the analysis that you've already ran. Now, under your event, you'll be able to set up the study. So what's nice about this is, so let's just say if you run, you know, multiple studies for your analysis, for your static analysis, you can actually create multiple events for your fatigue analysis. So you might have different iterations, perhaps different thicknesses or different configurations of the same model. And you can set up all the different events and have it run simultaneously. And you can check to see the failure analysis of all the different iterations that you have run previously. So for this case, I'm just going to say PT test 1. Say OK. And right away, it will bring all that information over from your previous static analysis. So if you take a look at the material here, it's all user defined. And if you right click on that, you can even say apply and edit your fatigue data. You can see that all that fatigue data was already included within my custom materials. Or you can also have this information if you've got the material from a vendor, and if you get this information, you can just type it right in. If you have an Excel file, you can copy and paste those cells right in here using copy paste. So if you take a look at this other material that we have here, you can also have your you can also define the curve for your fatigue right here. Say apply and close. So once you have all the fatigue information for your material setup, you can also check your fatigue properties for that specific run. So you could have the type of computing alternative stress using. So for this, I'm going to be using my principal stresses to analyze my fatigue 7 million cycles. We can also set up a mean stress correction. So for this analysis, I'm actually going to set the Gerber correction, which is very good for ductile material. And you can also set up a fatigue strength reduction factor. This is particularly important whenever you have any kind of material finish or any kind of notches in your model, you can set that up. So if you open up any materials textbook, you usually can find this reduction factor. In this case, I'm just going to put 0.5. So if you hit this help right here as well, you can get actually quite a bit of information on all these properties for your fatigue analysis right here. That's okay. So once you've set all this up, you can just right click and say run. You'd be able to see the results for your part. Now, for this for the fatigue analysis, we have the damage. So the damage percentage, you can see that it is quite high, 7,000% damage in certain areas of the heart. And we can even take a look at in terms of life, the amount of life cycle. So this will actually tell you at which cycle the part may fail. What I'm going to do here is I'm just going to flip this over. And show minimum. And right there, it actually shows me where that minimum cycle would be. So minimum life cycle for this part would show up in this area right here. So if you take a look at the in terms of damage, if you remember that picture earlier that we looked at, if you take a look at this fillet area right here, you can see that that fillet is starting to fail right there. So the, again, the results is close to actual environment, and this can be very important when you're designing parts that need to last over a certain period of time or over a certain number of cycles. Okay, so let's go back to our PowerPoint. So just to kind of summarize again what we did for our fatigue analysis, I talked a little bit about the importance of fatigue analysis, period of use, so you can define how long the product must last. So in this case, we had set up 7 million cycles. We can solve and view the results. So the type of results we get is the life and damage plots. It can tell you at which point it will fail. So over 7 million cycles, you can see that it might fail at 3.4 million cycles. So that will allow you to change your design accordingly. And last but not least, design iteration. So if you have multiple configurations, you can actually do a quick comparison. So if we step back into the software, you can see that I had previously run some analysis. So I can say compare results. I can say all studies in this configuration. All study in all configurations. And that will give you information for all the different configurations that you may have. So you can see that I have a few different designs for this crank, and you can actually see how that total life is changes for all the different parts that you have here. Okay, so just hit exit compare. That takes you right out. Okay, and this obviously will allow you to choose the best design for your for your part that you're designing. All right, so what about mechanism? So far up to this point, in the SOLIDWORKS simulation standard package, we've taken a look at all our static analysis. We've run it at an instantaneous point, and then we took it a step further. We did a fatigue analysis to see how this part will last over a certain amount of time. Now, what if you have an application which has some dynamics in it, it's moving around, and you would like to see what really is going on with your analysis and kind of get some information some strength information, some stress information based on your application. So that can also be done using our SOLIDWORKS motion analysis, which is included in the SOLIDWORKS simulation standard. And the basic setup for this is you have your physical setup. So any SOLIDWORKS model assembly that you have pre-set up can be used directly. You would have to set up some driving components for your assembly. You would solve and evaluate the results, and you could have again your design iterations, make any changes to it, and evaluate which may be better. So let's again go back to the software. So the model, the assembly that we have here is a medical couch, and it's an actuator system, and we actually allow it to move based on that actuator. And what's nice about the motion analysis that we have here is that when you have all your mates set up within your assembly, so as I had moved this, all that was pre-set up in your mechanism, that actually gets transferred over into your motion analysis that you can see right here. And we can actually use that motion to analyze how it's affecting your application. So for your motion analysis, you'll be able to set up motors in your analysis, if you have any kind of springs between components. You can set up a damper, so if there's any kind of vibration in the analysis, you can, and you have a damper in there, you can set that up. Clearly you can set up some forces. So in this case, if I want to evaluate perhaps a patient sitting on this chair, a certain force being applied on this chair, I can set that up as well. And obviously you can even set up gravity in this case. So for this motion that we have here, it was already pre-set up. You can actually take a look at how that looks. See how that actuator is going in and out. And that's the sound of actually it has ended the motion. So once you've taken it a step further, you've set the motion analysis. You can take a look in your office product. That motion, SOLIDWORKS motion, is turned on. It's indented. You'll be able to set up a linear motor in your system. So if I right click and just edit that, and actually take a look at the face. So the face that we picked is that piston face there, and the actual component itself is that motor that's been modeled within your SOLIDWORKS assembly. And you can even set up how the motion of that motor is being set up. So if we edit this, there are many different ways to set this up. So if I just cancel that for a second, you can either set it up at a constant speed using a certain distance. So if that actuator is moving from X to Y, you can set that up as well. You can set up based on data points or oscillation between a certain points. So for this case, I'm just going to say segments, and edit, and you can actually take a look at the start and the end. So this is going to start from 0.2 seconds to 2 seconds, 2 seconds to 4 seconds. We can set up the segment type, so half cosine, so it's going to its maximum point and dropping back down at 4 seconds. It will automatically calculate the acceleration for you based on the segments that you set up, and also the jerk, which is essentially the derivative of the acceleration. So all this will be automatically calculated for you based on what you set up in here. And you can also check what you want to see for this this function builder for the motion of the actuator. I'm just going to hit cancel right here. Exit out of this. So you can see that I also have a gravity set up in my my motion analysis here. And once you have all your simulation properties set up, you can actually just hit calculate. That will calculate the motion for every part that you see here. So I'm just going to pull this up. And you will be able to view some results right away. So if I drop this, just show the plot. You can see that I have some plots here. This is my linear displacement. And I also have another plot here, which is my motor force. So the amount of force that is being applied onto that actuator right there. So what's even better is once I have my results, I can actually play the animation again. And you can see that it actually moves through my pile. It actually shows me where the highest forces are and where the largest displacement is during that animation. So just to kind of take a look at it a little bit closer, it might be a little bit choppy, and that's because I'm kind of transmitting this over the internet. But you can actually kind of see clearly how that looks, and at any point, if you were to select that plot, it actually will give you that Newton, the amount of force on the graph. It shows you in real time. All right, so let's take a step back to my PowerPoint. So what about mechanisms? So the physical setup, any mate that you have within your assembly automatically gets translated as joints. So there's no dual setup. It's one setup. It the SOLIDWORKS simulation standard utilizes all the SOLIDWORKS functionalities. So you only have to set that up one time. You'd be able to set up that gravity right within your SOLIDWORKS motion itself. You can set up all sorts of driving components for your mechanism. So in this case, motors, springs, dampers, forces, and any kind of contacts between your assembly. You can solve and get results. So in this case, this is the results that we looked back. So you can get your dynamic feedback of any physical quantity that you see within your mechanism itself. And obviously, last but not least, again, you need to always compare our models, right? So the first model might not be the best. We might have an initial design and final design, and you can quickly run both iterations using configurations and compare those plots quickly. Okay. All right. So for your mechanisms, you can quickly test your mechanism design using SOLIDWORKS Motion, which comes with your SOLIDWORKS simulation standard. And again, this is a package which comes and can tie in with any version of SOLIDWORKS that you may already have right now. So next, so what design is the best? So this is a kind of a question that we've been going through with the fatigue analysis and again with the mechanism. However, when it comes to making changes in your analysis, you might want to track that changes. You might want to see, hey, what happens if I make a quick change to this fillet? You know, is the mass going to change? Is the stress going to go up? What if I want to go back to a previous iteration? So within SOLIDWORKS simulation standard, we do have a neat tool to track this, and this is actually called the trend tracker. Let me just go ahead and open up the model that we're going to work with. It's always a good idea to rebuild. So this is the model. So let's actually take a step back for a second. Let's kind of see where this is coming from. So So that all joint right there with the bracket actually comes from this suspension system. You can see that this tie rod right here is pushing on that ball joint, which is connected to that bracket. So what we are really concerned about in this analysis is those three components. So it's always a good idea to set up a configuration with a simplified model, and this can be easily done by simply suppressing all that other components, which just leaves you with this. And to set up the analysis, actually have an analysis preset up so we can actually talk about it as we did before the other analysis. So for this case, I have a couple of hinges here for where it's bolted. So just to kind of add on, in this case, we're really just concerned about how this bracket is reacting to that tie rod pushing on this ball joint right here. But if you really want to analyze, the bolt connections of these holes, we actually do have connectors where you can set up springs or pins or bolts or even bearings within your application. So if you have any kind of sheet metal assemblies, you can even set up spot welds or edge welds and analyze that and see whether it will be able to withstand certain forces being applied onto it. Again, all this is included in the SOLIDWORKS simulation standard. All right, so just to take a look at the force that we are applying here, right click this and say edit definition. So again, the way we are set it up is we can set the face, and using the arrows we can actually see the direction in which it's being applied. So for this analysis, we've actually selected direction. We are able to pick a face, so we've just picked a planar face right here, and we applied a force normal to that face, facing in that horizontal direction at 180 pounds. You can say okay. And so once you have your analysis set up, you can just quickly run it. And to be able to track the different changes that you have in your analysis, we do have a trend tracker. So I actually have a trend tracker right here. I'm just going to delete this so I can just show you how to go ahead and create that. So I've run my analysis, the first iteration. You can right click my study on the top, and I can say trend tracker, and it brings in the trend tracker right here. So what I could do is, with the first iteration that I have, I can just right click that trend tracker and I can say set that as the baseline. So that's where I'm going to start this analysis. I'm going to say set baseline, and I'm going to say yes. And what this does is it builds this trend journal and all the different trends that I intend to track within my model. So all this is actually coming right from your model, and it comes from your sensors. So when you set up all these different sensors in your model, you can set that up within your trend tracker as well. So let's go ahead and make a quick change to this analysis and see what happens. So I'm just going to go back into my model. I'm going to right click this fillet and unsuppress that. You can see that I have a nice cutout in there. And as soon as I change the geometry, you can see that I get I have the ability to basically rerun my analysis. I'm going to just say run. It'll say add trend tracker iteration. We'll save existing model. I'm going to say yes. And once that's done, we can actually take a look at some of the changes that may have happened from our first iteration to our second iteration. So by double clicking the mass, you can see here that the mass actually dropped, and obviously that's because of the cutout that we had. You can see the stress hasn't changed. Actually, let's see if it actually took into account that change that I put in the model. Right there. There you go. And so now we can actually make more changes to this analysis. So let's just say I want to have a smaller fillet here, so I can double click on that. Change that to 6. Rebuild my model. So now that's another iteration that I had introduced to my model. You can see that the mesh now has a warning on it. If you right click that and you say what's wrong, you see the mesh information is not current. Now this is essentially the warning that tells you that, hey, you changed your model, so you could rerun your mesh because it's a different geometry. And what you could actually do is if you run into your simulation and you just say run, that again now will be tracked into the trend tracker. So just to kind of take a look at some of the stresses that we have here, you can see that my stresses went from my first iteration, my second iteration, and for the third iteration it actually shot up. And for my mass, it clearly went down. So this actually makes it a lot easier for you to analyze some of the different changes that you have in your model. So at this point, you might say, well, I don't really want that second iteration. So by right-clicking that trend tracker, you will be able to delete any iteration that you may have. So I can say delete the existing iteration, or you can even restore your model to a previous iteration. So I want to go back to that first iteration, say, oh, maybe none of the cutouts worked for me in this case, so I just want to go back. You can also do that right in here. You can also view gallery for your trend tracker, and what that allows you to do is actually view all the changes that that you had within your iteration. So for the first with the cutout, without the cutout, and for the second with the cutout. All right. We also have a trend journal with the trend tracker. So if I open that up, that ties in right into your Microsoft Office. That gives you a nice document with all the changes for your masses, the stresses, the displacement, something that you can just print out and keep it with you. All right. All right, so the test setup, you'll be able to create your linear static analysis and set the baseline. You can create your plots based on your sensors, so you can set up what data you want to track. You can create your design iterations, and once you have your design iterations, you can try out the different designs, delete the ones that you don't want, keep the ones that you want. And obviously, last but not least, you have all these graphs which will give you the best results. Which is the best? You can pick the iteration that you want and continue working from that point on. All right, so just to kind of reiterate what we've done today is that we've tried to answer all these questions. So in your design environment, if you're asking any of these questions, which you should be, SOLIDWORKS simulation standard would be the best solution for you. SOLIDWORKS simulation standard, obviously, it's a short learning curve. Because it uses the same user interface as SOLIDWORKS, it's very consistent, a lot of right clicks to give you the options. Clearly it reduces development costs and time, and clearly whenever you cut costs and you save time, it allows you to innovate and design better products, and that will allow you to stay ahead of your competitors. All right. So if you want to know more about SOLIDWORKS Simulation Standard, please feel free to shoot me an email at sashi@catdimensions.com. Please also visit us online at www.catdimensions.com to get more information on how to contact us. I also wanted to remind many of you in the area that Cat Dimensions is currently running our rollout events. So we would actually be having a rollout event tomorrow in Syracuse. We have one in Rochester on October 21st, and we have another one in Buffalo on October 23rd. Please go onto our website and reserve your seat if you're in the area. We would love for you to come in and spend the day with us to kind of learn what's new in SOLIDWORKS 2015. And also in the afternoon, I will be having a session on what's new in SOLIDWORKS Simulation 2015. A lot of new and pretty cool enhancements. So thank you for joining me today. If you have any questions, please